blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song,
brothers and sisters in Christ. I trust everything finds you well this morning. And whether you're listening from Asheville, whether you're listening from Burlington or Lakeview or Pomeroy, I'm grateful as always to have this opportunity to break God's word of truth with you. And I pray today that as we have gathered together, wherever we happen to be gathered together at, that we'll be challenged and encouraged and built up by faith today, by God's word and through His Spirit. And I pray for you today. If you're a person listening to my voice today and you do not have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus, I pray today that will be your day of salvation and that you will come to know what it means to have a relationship with the living God in the person of Jesus Christ. And so so let's dig into the scripture this morning. I'm going to ask you, if you will, to take your Bibles and turn with me to Acts chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. I want to just kind of pick up a continuation of Luke's story as I preached last week on Luke 8. And I want to speak to you this morning on the subject of the ministry of God's message, the ministry of God's message. You know, one of the things that I'm always encouraged by and fascinated by is when you talk to people and they tell you about their passions. You know, one of the things I'd like to do is I like to talk to people. And so as I talk to people, I oftentimes will say, tell me a little bit about yourself. And then I'll normally ask, so tell me, what's your passion? What do you really get excited about doing? What are you really committed to? And it's always interesting to hear what people say, you know, what they tell you about. As I was thinking about passion, you know, the fall of the year is around the corner. We're getting ready to get out of spring and into summer. And we know that one thing in Ohio that people are passionate about is Ohio State football. In fact, I have read a few things on Facebook and have been thrown out there in blogs and said, Lord, no matter what you do with this COVID thing, just don't let it interrupt or cancel Ohio State football. And so that certainly would be a passion for many people. I think about people who have a passion for physical activity. I certainly have had a passion for physical activity in my life. You know, I think about the things that now that are popular right now. Orange Theory is a workout. Running or biking or swimming or walking. There's a particular guy in my neighborhood that I love to speak to. He was a little overweight, and several years ago he bought a dog and began to walk that dog. And in his walking with that dog and the pace of their walking, he's lost about 45 pounds. And so just encouraged by people who have a passion for physical activity. Some people have a passion for reading. You know, I own almost every one of Warren Wiersbe's books, a great theologian. Through the years, been encouraged by him many times, not only in person, but by his writings and by his videos. And my mother-in-law loved to read all the books that were written by John Grisham. And there's other people that have loved to do certain amount of readings with novels and biographies and stories. And so people have a passion for those kind of things. You know, we're at the time of the year also where people have a passion for gardening and planting. I was doing some planting the other day in our front yard, and it's that time to begin to do those things to beautify, you know, the properties that we have or the farms that we own, to do the gardening and doing the planting and sowing and reaping and all that. One of the things that's been very, very evident to me, a passion for people during the COVID, is a passion for a kind of a reinvention and a reigniting and a regathering of family. Most of us are so busy that we take our families for granted. And one of the things that I hope and pray that will be an outpouring, an outcome of this particular COVID, is this the re-energizing of the American family, the realization of how we need to get together and pray together and study together and be together, even in the midst of closeness, even in the midst of, you know, our lives and our differences and all of that. I mean, I have an adult child that's living with us, and I can't treat her like a child, even though she is my child. You know, she's a young lady, and so she speaks up much more boldly these days than maybe she once would have. But that's part of the transition of understanding and enjoying family. And then certainly we would want to have a passion for faith. For those of us who are Christ followers, we certainly would want to seek God. We would want to serve God. We'd want to share the message of Jesus with others. And so as I think about the ministry of God's message, one of the things that we have to have is we have to have a passion, a deep desire to be people of faith. And so in Luke 9, and maybe to think, in Luke 8, we transitioned by seeing, or we observed in Luke 8, the things that Jesus did. I mean, he was the one that was at the center of doing these things, whether it was the storm, or whether it was the casting out of the demons, whether it was raising Jairus' daughter back to life, or curing the woman of her issue of blood. It was Jesus doing those things. When chapter 9 of Luke, there's a transition, and now Jesus empowers the disciples, the 12, to go out and do the things that he was doing. And so what Jesus' intention in beginning of Luke 9 is to get the message of the kingdom and the kingdom's hope across the nation of Israel. And so what he does to accomplish this, he commissions the 12 to minister for him in the towns and villages of the nation. And at the core of this sending are two really underlying truths that will be a backdrop for the message this morning. One is just the hope found in God's kingdom in regard to its arrival. So many people were expecting an arrival of the kingdom of God, and Jesus was the fulfillment of that kingdom. His coming announced the kingdom. He embodied the kingdom. He spoke of the kingdom. Now, unfortunately, many didn't expect that kind of kingdom to come. They were expecting something much different than what they got in Jesus, and for some of them, it was very, very confusing. But there was a hope in the coming of the kingdom. The other was that the compassionate service found in the kingdom is doing good deeds. And so part of what we have to do as Christians is not only say the word, speak the word, but we need to do good deeds. As I've reminded you before, 1 John 3:18 says, let us not love with just words and in tongue, but with action and in truth. And so part of that is being able to not only announce, speak it, but now also to do it, to do these acts of service and show compassion in that. And so with that as the backdrop, I'd like to speak to you, like I said this morning, from Luke chapter 9, speaking of the ministry of the message, the ministry of God's message. And so follow along with me as I read Luke chapter 9, beginning verse 1, and we want to read just to down to verse 9. The Bible says, summoning the 12, he gave them power and authority over all the demons and power to heal diseases. Then he sent them to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Take nothing for the road, he told them, no walking stick, no traveling bag, no bread, no money, and don't take an extra shirt. Whatever house you enter, stay there and leave from there. If they do not welcome you, when you leave that town, shake off the dust from your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and traveled from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing everywhere. Now Herod the Tetrarch heard about everything that was going on, and he was perplexed because some said that John had been raised from the dead. Some said that Elijah had appeared, and others that one of the ancient prophets had risen. Well, Herod said, I beheaded John, but who is this that I hear such things about? And the Bible says he wanted to see him. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading, hearing, doing of his word. Let's pray together. Father, again, we thank you for not only the ability to read your word, but to heed your word. So this morning, as we think about our responsibility in our ministry, the message that you have given us, may we take the practical lessons that we learn from the principles you share in your word, apply them to our lives, that we might be more about the kingdom, not only the announcement of your kingdom, but then doing those acts of service in word, and not only in word, but in deed, that people might see that you truly do care and that you truly do love them. And so this morning, just empower us by your Spirit to hear and then to do, and we'll give you praise for it in Jesus' name. I'm going to share with you just three simple observations this morning from these nine verses in regard to the ministry of God's message. The first observation is this. I want you to notice the power that is given. The power that is given. We find that in verses 1 and 2. So when Jesus calls the 12 together, he gives them the power and authority over all the demons and the power to heal diseases. And then notice in verse 2 it says, then he sent them to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. And so the sick. So the first thing I want you to notice about this power is that it does give us the power to confront. Specifically here, he talks about the power to confront the demons. And throughout the ministry of the Lord Jesus, one of the things that we see him continually doing is he's continually confronting the demonic, the spiritual forces of the world and the culture and context in which he found himself. And as I've mentioned before and a little bit last week, we kind of minimize the demonic forces, the spiritual battles and fights that are going on around us all the time. Because we've watched too many movies, or we have this preconceived notion that that's really not real. And the thing that makes it hard for us to understand and accept is the reality that it's the unknown. It's the things that we don't see. I imagine that if we could spend just 5 minutes observing the spiritual battles that take place around us in the spiritual realm, we would have a much better understanding and a much better undertaking of the reality of the spiritual fights that are fighting around us. And so there are instances in the Bible, and think about when Daniel was praying, and remember that one of the archangels said that he struggled in getting there because he was in battle with Satan. So there was a spiritual warfare that was taking place that we couldn't see with physical eyes, but certainly was taking place in the spiritual realm. And so today we have demonic forces all around us. I mean, there are demons of oppression and alcoholism and drug abuse and immorality and debauchery. I mean, all these demons that attack our hearts and minds, we need to be aware that in God's power, we have the power to overcome them. We have the power to confront them. As the Bible says, if we will resist the devil, that he will flee from us. Second observation here is the power to cure and to heal. In other words, to bring wholeness out of brokenness. I have such a great appreciation for doctors and nurses that do what they do, who administer medicines to us, and we have medical procedures. And certainly that is one of the ways that God does cure and heal. In that day, in the day in which he walked, he did that instantaneously. People who were lame all of a sudden could walk. People who were blind all of a sudden could see. People who were deaf all of a sudden could speak. And so as Jesus had been doing this, now he transitions and hands this off to his apostles to do the same thing. And don't lose sight of the fact that you and I have the ability and the power of God to bring wholeness, to wholeness and completeness to people in the brokenness of their lives. I've never experienced myself a miraculous healing, though I know that God used medicine to heal me of my cancer. But I do know people who have experienced that. And it has been a great rejoicing story to hear those stories about how God has cured and healed them. And so part of the power that is given in the ministry of God's message is that we have the power to confront. We also have the power to cure and heal. And then we also have the power to preach. In other words, the kingdom, one of the things we have to be mindful of is to preach the kingdom, and the kingdom is about Jesus. It's interesting to notice in verse 2, the Bible talks about proclaim the kingdom of God. And then in verse 6, it talks about proclaiming the good news of God, which is the gospel. And so one of the things that we can't separate, and one of the things that was confusing in that time and what the apostles need to learn and Jesus knew, is that you can't separate God's kingdom and Jesus. Again, Jesus embodies the kingdom. The keys to the kingdom are found in Jesus. He's the exact representation. He's the glory of the radiance of God on earth as he walked the earth, and we've been able to observe him, the Bible tells us. And so one of the things we have to be mindful of as we undertake this ministry, the message in this day and age in which we live, is that we have the power that has been given to us and the authority that has been given to us by Jesus himself. That's why he says in Matthew 28 in the Great Commission, he says, all authority has been given to me, therefore go and proclaim the good news, baptize folks, teach them to observe, and then don't forget that I've been with you always, even to the end of the age. And here's the life application for you and I. Whatever we accomplish in life as a believer, it is from God's power and for God's glory. And notice that it benefits others and it benefits ourselves. And so as Jesus is sending them, he's not doing that to glorify them. He's doing it to glorify himself and to advance the kingdom. And when Jesus glorifies himself, or he's glorified himself and then advances the kingdom, people's lives are impacted. And so the challenge here, and one of the truths here, is that when we serve Jesus and walk in the power that Jesus walked in and gives us, we have the power to see our lives changed and the power to see other people's lives changed. And so let's not forget that, hey, as we're doing this ministry, the power that has been given us is given us by the authority that Jesus owns. The second observation I want you to notice is that of the process that is undertaken. The process that is undertaken. Notice verses 3 through 5. He tells them first, trust me. In other words, don't take anything. Don't take a walking stick. Don't take a traveling bag. Don't take bread. Don't take money. Don't take an extra shirt. And one of the things that maybe we could look over here is that in that day and age, there were people who went from town to town and preached certain things and taught certain things, but they would beg for the support of the people when they went to do it. And so one of the things that Jesus was wanting to make sure of is that, listen, we don't want people meeting your provision, though they can and they will. Obviously, a person of peace would invite you into their home. But he says, you trust me. Ultimately, you got to trust me for your provision. And I know that right now in COVID, we've got, you know, tons of people that are unemployed and people that are out of work and people that have been furloughed, and they're not necessarily sure that they'll be called back when all this is done. But as believers, we need to trust the Lord. You'll not see the righteous begging for bread, the Father tells us. And also that, you know, the wealth of the unrighteous is laid up for the righteous. And so when we walk by faith, and again, in the power of God's word, he promises to meet our provision. And so part of this undertaking of taking the message to the masses was, as you're doing it, trust me to meet your provision. Another thing that's mentioned here is he really is kind of saying, take some time. Whatever house you enter, he says in verse 4, stay there and leave from there. So one of the things I want you to understand is when we're undertaking the ministry to the masses and the message of God, it takes time. We've got to invest our time. At least here he talks about spending some time in a particular place. So oftentimes when we do ministry, we do it from a guerrilla perspective rather than from an infiltration perspective. So if you think about warfare for a minute, guerrilla warfare is kind of incognito, is kind of hit and miss. You're attacking people, you're getting in, and then you're getting out. Infiltration is not only do you do some guerrilla warfare, but more importantly, you get in. It's like the old saying, you know, you can't change City Hall unless you're in City Hall. And so part of what we need to undertake is we're thinking about the ministry of God's message is that it's a process that takes time. And oftentimes it means staying in one place longer than maybe we would expect. Think about as you're investing in people's lives, especially those that do not know Christ yet, the process and the time that it has taken. I remember one of the deacons of my first church, it took 40 years for his wife witnessing to him and to be a witness to him and before him with her relationship with Christ that eventually brought him to the Lord. I mean, it took 40 years of time before he came to Christ, and in the last 20 years of his life, he has been serving the Lord greatly. So as we think about the process that is undertaken, let's remember that we need to trust the Lord. We need to be aware that it takes time. And then the other thing is we got to be mindful that we need to be in transit. In other words, people have to be moving from one place to another. In verse 5, he says, well, if they don't welcome you, which is a testimony to the rejection of the message, when you leave that town, shake off the dust from your feet as a testimony. And then he says what? Then they went out and traveled from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing everywhere. And so one of the things that Jesus mentioned at least a couple times in the Gospels is that I can't just stay here. I got to go to other towns and preach the good news. And so part of what we do is there's a time to stay put as we're doing ministry, but then there's also a time to be moving. I think the COVID gives us a little bit of a picture about this is that, you know, for the most part, things have always happened kind of in the church and around the church. Well, in COVID, nothing's been happening in the church. Everything's been happening in the community and out in society. And so we take the message in transit. We go from one place to another and we tell people about the good news of Christ. And so it's always great to spread the word. You know, that's what a thrower of seed or a person who seeds and sows seed, you know, they're throwing it. They're not just putting all their seeds in one particular spot. You know, if you think about a farmer's field, I mean, he's got acres and acres and acres of field to throw the seed and to plant the seed. And so he's in transit. He's doing it at one particular field, then he's moving to another field, then he's moving to another field. And so as we think about the ministry of God's message, we have to trust the Lord to meet our provision as we're doing it. We have to realize that it does take time to impact people's lives, but we also need to share it with as many people as possible. And so we need to be on the move also. So the life application, I believe, here is telling people about Jesus not only takes time, it involves engagement, and then sometimes it's met with opposition. Sometimes people just don't want to hear about Christ, and they don't want to hear about the Word of God. But that should not stop us from continuing on in this process of going to the highways and byways. As Acts 1:8 would say it, you know, go into all the world and preach the gospel, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. Last observation I want you to take notice of this morning in this ministry of God's message is the not only the power that has been given, the process that is undertaken, but the perplexing question that needs answered, which is, just who is Jesus? Notice verse 7. So Herod, he hears about everything that Jesus is doing, everything that's going on. He's perplexed, and perplexed means to be baffled, to be puzzled, to be confused. Because some are saying, you know, it's John that's been raised, John the Baptist. Some say it's Elijah, or others just say it's just one of the prophets. And this would parallel much of what was undertaken in Matthew 16 when Jesus took the apostles to Caesarea Philippi and said, you know, go out in the highways and byways of this community and ask people who I am. And some came back and basically said the same kind of things. You know, one say you're John, one say you're Jeremiah, one say you're just one of the prophets. But his point to them and his question to them was, and his question to us, the most important question is, well, then who do you say that I am? And so Herod gives us this glimpse. And so who is Jesus? Well, is he a prophet? Is he someone who just has the authority to teach? We certainly know that at the conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount that the people said that they listened to him so intently because he had such authority to preach. You know, no one had spoke like him before. You know, when he was in the temple or at the age of 12, you know, and he began to preach, and he opens up the book of Isaiah, and he tells the people there that, hey, by the way, this scripture is fulfilled this day in your presence. I mean, they about lost their minds. You know, who is this 12? Who is this carpenter son? You know, who is this kid that knows so much? Well, because he was a prophet, he certainly could teach with such great clarity because he was the one who was writing the words. I mean, he is the Logos. He is the living Word of God. And so, is he a prophet? Is he a radical? Some people just see Jesus as a radical. I mean, John the Baptist was a radical. I mean, he was strange looking. His message was an in-your-grill kind of message. I mean, he called the Pharisees and the scribes and Sadducees in the scriptures a brood of vipers. He called them a bunch of snakes. So this guy was a guy who, because of his confrontation to Herod, eventually got his head lopped off. You know, he was beheaded because of his challenge to people to repent. Because why? Because the kingdom of God has come. The kingdom has come, and he even mentioned to his disciples, when they saw Jesus, said, hey, there's the Lamb of God who taketh away the sin of the world. The kingdom is him. And so follow him. And certainly we know that some of his followers, John the Baptist did follow Jesus. So some people see Jesus, you know, just as a prophet. Some people see him as a radical. And then at least in Elijah's case, some see Jesus as a confronter. Now, if you think about the ministry of Elijah that's found over there in 2 Kings, over in the book of Kings, is that, you know, Elijah was a confronter. You know, he's thrust into the situation in Scripture. He goes to King Ahab, who, by the way, was the worst king ever. He confronts King Ahab about his sin, and he basically tells him, by the way, it's not going to rain for 3.5 years except by my word, for a time but by my word. Then he has to confront his own belief and his own trust in God's provision and his understanding of God's plan, because then he goes by the brook Kidron, and the ravens, we know, miraculously provide food for him. And then he goes from there to the widow of Zarephath, and then he has to confront her lack of faith and the lack of provision that she has. And God, of course, miraculously provides. And then her son dies, and then Elijah lays on the son and brings the son back to life. And then next thing we know, he goes back and he confronts Ahab again. He's confronting Ahab in regard to his sin. And then he confronts the prophets of Baal and calls all these guys. And we know the great story of the sacrifice that takes place and how they call on their gods and nothing happens. And they're cutting themselves and wailing all day long. And Elijah's kind of laughing at him, going, you know, is he taking a nap? Is your God, you know, asleep? Is he on vacation? And then, you know, he says, oh, by the way, you know, with the sacrifice, pour water on everything, pour on water again, pour on water again. And then whoever God's God will answer by fire. And of course, we know that God does answer by fire. And then he confronts the nation of Israel too. He tells them, say, hey, how long are you going to waver between two opinions? If God's God, serve God. If Baal's Baal, serve God, you know, serve him as God. And so he challenges them to waver. But, you know, sometimes even confronters can be cowards and lose their courage because we know that Jezebel gets after him, and next thing you know, he runs and he hides in a cave, and God says, what in the world are you doing in this cave? Get out of this cave, Elijah. And of course he does, and then he hands the ministry over to Elisha. And so it's just this perplexing question that Herod had, that, you know, who is Jesus? Who is this that I'm hearing such things about? And you know what, friends? The same things are being talked about today. People are still curious. They're kind of baffled. They kind of misunderstand who Jesus is. And so the life application for us, I believe, here is, you know, we just can't see Jesus as a showman. We can't see him as someone who we just go watch and then not be changed by. But we need to see Jesus as a savior of our souls. He's the Lamb of God that was slain before the foundation of the earth. And the reason why I use the term showman, because if you were to look ahead in Luke's gospel in chapter 23, verse 8, we find Herod there when the trials are going on and Jesus is about ready to be crucified and killed. He just wanted to see Jesus, to see what Jesus could do before him, because he was kind of fascinated by what people could do in this miraculous, you know, foreseeing and soothsayers and that. And he had a lot of those kind of people around him in the throne. And so as we conclude, let's think about the ministry of the message of God. Why do we do it? Because he's given us the power to do it, because he has the authority over all of creation so that his message would go forward. There certainly is a process, and each church undertakes a different kind of process. It's a very similar and a familiar. Core principles are the same, but each church does church a little bit different. Each person witnesses a little bit different. We go about the highways and byways of our life telling people. And then really what we're doing is, when we're witnessing to people, is we're trying to answer that those questions of their hearts and minds and lives of who is Jesus. So who is Jesus? Well, he's the Savior of the world. He's the one who paid the sin debt for you and for me. And I want to close and make sure we understand it. It's not a message of condemnation. It's good news. It's a message of compassion and hope. The reality of the people living in Jesus' days is they saw this man, this prophet, this God-man, meeting their needs at the deepest core of their lives where it was needed and necessary. And many came to saving faith because he met their need. But then some just wanted to see the show. They were grateful for the things he did, but they went about the rest of their lives. And so we have people today to do the exact same thing. So as I close this morning, let me ask you, do you have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus? Do you know him as Savior and Lord? Or are you like Herod? You're just curious. You just want to see the show, or you just want to hear the stories and never really make a decision. If you do that and you don't make a decision to accept him, and this is not condemning, but it is reality, then there's judgment coming to your life down the road. May not be today, may not be tomorrow, may not be for 30, 40 years, but eventually there's judgment coming to your life. And the way that we get away from the judgment and find the hope of the kingdom is to confess our sins and ask Jesus to come into our heart. And you do that simply by just confessing your sins. You could pray a simple prayer like this prayer. Father, forgive me of my sins. I ask you to come into my heart and life. Forgive me of my sins. I want to give my heart and life to you. I don't know all that that means, but I do know that I need a Savior and you are him. So come into my life and guide me and direct me that I might live a life that, number one, fulfills your purposes for my life, but also that is fulfilling and purposeful and satisfying and enjoyable. And that would bring hope into the midst of the difficulties of my life that I'm experiencing right now. And if you'll do that and you'll confess that and you'll believe that, the Bible says that Jesus will come into your heart and forgive you of your sins. How are you doing, Christian? Are you about the ministry of the message? Are you keeping it to yourself? You keeping it under that bushel? You keeping it under the light, or the bushel covering the light? Or are you shining the light in the darkness? I hope that at every opportunity, in word or in deed, that you are sharing the message of Christ as best you can. You're discouraged today, there's hope in Christ. You're overwhelmed today, there's hope in Christ. If you're sick today with COVID, there is hope in Christ. And so I pray that today you will know him, find him, and you will enjoy the life that he gives. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you again for your word and for its truth, for the fact that there is hope in the coming of the kingdom, and the coming of the kingdom is embodied in our hearts and minds now for those of us who know you. and the coming of the kingdom certainly will come again when you return again and take your church home and separate those who are righteous and those who are unrighteous. I pray specifically for the person who needs you today. May they know the power of your presence. May they know the joy of your spirit. May they know the peace that passes all understanding. And may they know that you care, that you are there, you are near, and all they need to do is call upon you today. Cry out to you for help, and you are willing and able to help them. Thank you for the authority that we have, because it gives us the forgiveness of sins. It gives us the power to proclaim, and it gives us the great joy of living abundant life that we find in Jesus. For we pray in his name, amen. If you made a decision today, any kind of decision, would you just text me? 614-309-9738, 614-309-9738. Just text me a message concerning who you are and decision you made. I'll follow up with you and make sure that you get the resources you need to continue on in the commitment you make and the life change that you are seeking. So again, God bless you. I hope you have a great week. Look forward to seeing you again next Sunday. Bye-bye.